Hello friends, today we will understand what is about analytics. And when we are trying to understand this term as analytics, we also have to become aware what is analysis, how this analytics compares with analysis, and what are the types of analysis, the levels in the analytics which we do, and where are the domains of analytics, and also we will try to understand what the common data mining data analytical model which is used in the industry today. So this will be our agenda, comparing analysis with analytics, finding out what are the levels of analytics, also looking at the skill set of analyst and the data scientists, which are today you find them as one of the most hottest careers going around. And so we'll be looking at the various analytical domain which are coming up because of the utilization of the data. And also we'll be looking at the CRISP data mining modeling, what does it consist of. And also we'll also be trying to find out what are the types of data-driven organization, what are the characteristics of data-driven organizations. Coming to analysis and analytics, and in this we'll be comparison and look at the skill set of analytics here. So what is analysis? And this particular term we have been using for a long time, and what is it? Is it a systematic examination and evaluation of data or information by breaking into its component parts to uncover relationships? So what, whenever we get a set of data, we break it into small parts, or we probably look at from one product to the other, look at from one character to the other, we break it into parts and then trying to find out their relationships. A simple example would be, we are trying to find out what has been the sales of each product with respect to year, with respect to month. It has been the basis of problem solving and decision making. Sometimes you realize you have spent more into a particular ad campaign and you have not gotten enough returns. So probably you may like to relook at your decision making, and also trying to solve problems like when you're looking at the operational side, machine problem, a lot of many defects happening. So probably this kind of analysis will help you try to solve many problems of the industry, whether you're looking at the business, marketing, or finance, or any kind of domain. Coming into analytics, it consists about, it involves the studying of past historical data to research potential trends, to analyze effects of certain decisions or events, or to evaluate the performance of a given tool or scenario. It's more about predicting future scenarios without actually having to go about executing them. So it saves a lot of money in actually taking those actions. This analytics is aimed at improving the business by gaining more knowledge. So when you are doing analytics, you would be definitely doing analysis. So this is the step before that. But analytics is more focused on the future part. So let us see the simple difference between them. So analysis looks backwards over time and provides a historical view of what happened in the past. While in analytics, we are trying to use the data which is of the past, but our here motive is to look forward to model the future or predict the results. We want to make a better future. We want our business to improve in the future times, because in the past we cannot do any changes. So what we will be doing is analytics. So what are we doing? What is there in analytics? We will be describing the next few slides. So what is analytics? It helps to understand the future from the past data and uncertainty related to business. It is a sophisticated process that uses statistics, mathematics, and economic models to predict the future and prescribe strategies. It aims at discovering pattern or variation from the given data. So there are a lot of patterns which gets created, ups and downs, seasonal data, getting affected by certain conditions. It is a science of wisely acquiring meaningful results from a given data using various methods and technologies. So in turn, it becomes analytics, analytical modeling or analytical exercise become the art and science. So there is a scientific way to do it, but there's always a man behind doing it, doing it in a much creative manner so that we can create the best, get the best insights. So how do these analytics work? The most important part here is starts with the gathering data. Because the data, without the data, you cannot do any analysis or analytics here. Then we need to organize it, and then the analysis process starts. So what is analysis? What is analytics, and what does not is analytics? So data analytics is basically refers to the qualitative, that means good, bad, and quantitative in terms of numerical techniques and processes used to enhance the productivity and business gain. So the analytical process would involve doing some kind of prediction model, some kind of linear regression. What is data analytics is not is, is a big data AI or a machine learning. It's these are the new latest buzzword which are coming in. So as of now, data analytics does not consist of AI, while rather it consists of the qualitative and quantitative techniques and processes by which it can improve our business. So what are the skills required to become to work on an analytical domain? So, and since we are, as an analytical person, we are dealing with data, sometimes we always prefixed by data analytics, data analytical, data analysts. So what do these people do? They collect, organize, interpret statistical information to make it useful for a range of businesses and organizations. So this is something which they are doing on a daily basis. A data analyst is someone who scrutinizes the information using the data analysis tool, like probably to be R, SPSS, and Python. The meaningful results which comes out from there, they pull from the raw data. It helps the employers and clients make important decisions by identifying various facts and trends. And some of the typical duties would include using advanced computerized models to extract the data needed, which we'll be learning through this course. Removing any corrupted data or any data which is cannot be utilized. Performing different levels of analysis to assess the quality of data, or what quality we have got. Derive the meaning from it and provide the screening also. Sometimes filtering is required. It also involves preparing reports based on analysis and presenting it to the management in a manner where they can take decisions. So these are some skills which our data analyst should have. And when we put it in a form of infographic, they look like this. So you need to be aware of the analytical tools like R, and you cannot do without that. You need to be aware of how data mining is done. You should have, be able to test your modeling. You should have some basic statistical skills and some machine learning and the algorithms. And also very important part of it is data visualization. Until and unless you can make a graph, you cannot understand large data. So what should they have? They should have high mathematical ability. You may be wondering why mathematics is coming now. But if you have a good mathematical ability, you are definitely likely to become a good data analyst. You should have some knowledge of programming skills, ability to analyze, model, and interpret the data. If you're presented with the data, how can you model it? This is a very important ability. You should have problem solving skill, because when you are using data, you are ultimately doing it for solving a problem. You should have a methodological, analogical approach to dealing and to doing modeling. You should be able to plan work and meet deadline, because this is a very high pressure jobs, and you may not get results in the one iteration. You may have to rework many times. Accuracy and attention to detail is required, because you may do import a wrong data, or you may perform a wrong modeling techniques that might predict some wrong results. You should have good interpersonal skills, because you would be not working on your own. You would be interacting with many people who would be providing your data, or working with management. So you need to have good interpersonal skills and also working in team. You should have good verbal and communication skills, because any input and output requires communicating with various levels and various agencies, understanding the customer requirement, presenting the management. So these are the general skills, ability which a data analyst should have in whichever domain it is working. And who have been the analytical employers? Let's look at that. So the banks have employing these data analysts a lot. You find a lot of job opportunities there, because this consists of a lot of financial data and a lot of analysis is happening, especially in terms of maybe stock market analysis. So even software companies are using it for analysis. Consultancies like KPMG, Accenture, and Deloitte, various many telecommunication companies, Airtel, any Vodafone, they were trying to see which schemes customers are buying, how much they are talking, how much they're spending on the data. The public sector organizations like BHEL, ONGC, they are a big organization and which consume a lot of data, and they are also doing analysis a lot. Social media specialists like Facebook, Google Plus, a lot of Twitter, they also do a lot of analysis. Colleges and universities, a lot of data is getting generated in these colleges here. Again, this is used in a domain called learning analytics, where we can predict student performance, we can predict how much of admissions are likely to happen. Pharma companies are also using, medical is a sector which is using a data analytics a lot. Manufacturers, yes, definitely, because they have a big supply chain management chain here. And there's operation, there are industry, there are factories, there are machines, there are defects happening, there is Six Sigma techniques. So all these domains and many more, and wherever probably data is get created, I think those domains do need a data analyst, and all these employers here are looking for such people. But when we are looking at the data, there are three primary kind of people which come out as per the core specialization there. Let's look at them: engineers, specialist scientists, and analysts. So when we look at these three people which are primarily coming out from their respective domains are data engineer, there's a data scientist, and a data business analyst here. When you are working on the domain side, where or the business side or probably organization perspective, or from a customer perspective, so you are basically a business analyst. You have good domain knowledge and you have certain statistical skills, which you can see from the infographic here. And when you're looking from the data scientist point of view, he's basically a person who's got computer skills, statistical skills majorly, and some domain knowledge. And computer science is a knowledge which is primarily required by a data engineer who's basically into storage of data in your computer system, like big data Hadoop engineers. We have high pay SQL, Hadoop systems. So he would be a data engineer. He would be more concerned about storing a data. Data scientists would be concerned about creating data models, abstract data models. And a business analyst would be looking at the data from the business perspective. And if you see the data skills breakdown here, the programming skills are maximum required by a data engineer. Like if you're into Hadoop or probably managing a Java system, so he would be a person who would be requiring high programming skills. But if you look at the data exploration, the last graph here, you would find the data exploration is more done by the analyst and the data scientist, and less by the data engineer. He's not very much concerned about data exploration. And if you look at the probably the communication and visualization, the data analyst is the one who would be communicating a lot. So he would be interacting with the customer, the organization, the clients, and their top management, and interacting and trying to explain to them what does this data mean and how this data can help them improve their business. So communication is one of the key skills of a business analyst. And you can see from this right side infographic here, a data analyst, all of them probably need the good programming tools. So you need to be good at it. There's nothing, you cannot ignore this skill at all. And data visualization is also a skill which is primarily found in a data analyst and data scientist. And the other skills, which are a little minor, is about data understanding and statistics. So you, as a business person who looking from a domain perspective, you should have key skills on programming, data visualization, and some statistics. And these are some minor skills, which may not, like software engineering and working on pure mathematics, may not be very important. But for a person who machine learning or from a data scientist point of view, yes, some mathematical skills would be required. So how do I summarize a data analyst and a data scientist? Data scientist is somebody who would be research, who do research and extract information from various sources. And there are ERP system, from blogs, from Twitter, from Facebook, to describe the main features of data set in support of business operations and decision making. So his idea of working with data is to support the business operation, to improve the productivity, to see that the ROIs are being met here. While a data scientist is trying to apply various techniques to large data set and create visualization. His purpose is to answer more abstract business questions. Like if you increase this variable, you are likely to have a better output. So he's looking at more of predictive insights and probably anticipatory behavior if you perform it this way. He's trying to answer the basic abstract questions here, not from a particular domain perspective. So his skills are more in towards some statistics, while from a data analyst, he's more business driven, looking at how a particular model technique affects your particular business process. So what are the various domains in analytics? And we have been hearing, and you have been doing various courses in various management colleges and institutions here. So let's look at these various domain names here. So there could be business analytics, which will be probably focused on the business processes. There would be marketing analysts who would be trying to see the ROI return from the marketing campaigns is high, looking at the effectiveness of that. Financial analytics would be looking at how effective is the financial management. Learning analytics in the domain which is basically linked to your education and where we can predict the student performance based on the activities he's undertaking, and also able to predict any dropouts which is going to happen. Like that, you have HR, fraud analytics, healthcare analytics, where in a medical science, in medical domain, it is being used a lot, where you can predict student predict people's age or probably lifetime or probably health status, or when he's likely to get a heart attack. So these are various types of analytical domains which are coming up. So let's look at a few of them. And the first one we are going to see is the business analytics here. When we are looking at business analytics, a term which is often used is called business intelligence, which is basically it focuses on using a consistent set of metrics to measure past performance and guide the business planning, which is based on the data and statistical models. So here we are trying to measure our past performance so that we can do some kind of business planning. A simple example would be how much did we spend on the campaign and how much sales did we get, so that we can work on planning for the next year. While business analytics refers to the skills like problem solving skills, technologies like probably machine learning techniques and the programming are the predictive models and practices for continuous iterative exploration. Why continuous? Because you have to keep doing it. It is not analytical. Analytics is something one day activity. It is a regular affair. You have to keep checking whether your predictive model is working perfectly or right or not. And investigation of past, again, when you are doing all this, first you check on the past data and you trying to gain insight from this data, and then focus on creating new insights. Probably how can we increase the sales better? And if our decrease on this much a price of an item, will it increase the sales? So we are looking at new insights, and also this analytical is also based on the data and statistical methods. So it uses extensive statistics and predictive modeling and a fact-based management. And it's also closely, that's why related to management science. So what is BI and BA? In BI, we try to answer this question, what happened? And in B, business analytics, answer why it happened and whether it is going to happen again. So these are, and in BI, we try to create a dashboard, while we try, in BA, we try to create a various statistical modeling and multivariate testing here. So BI is about past, business analytics is about future. In BI, we are trying to what happened, when, who, and how many. And BA, we are trying to what will happen, what's next, which is going to happen here. And business, we are creating various dashboards, scoreboard, some ad hoc queries. And while in BA, we are trying to create a predictive modeling, data mining, and various types of quantitative analysis. So let's look at marketing. This has been the BA part of it. Marketing analytics is the practice of measuring, managing, analyzing the marketing performance to maximize the effectiveness and optimize return of investment. So companies are spending a lot of money on the ad campaigns through various ad, TV, social media, and pamphlets and print media. They want to really know how effective has been their campaign. Has the sales increased or decreased, or was there an effect, more effect on a particular type of campaign? Or they are trying to measure and analyze all this data there. And if a marketing manager knows the skills, they can become more efficient and in fact minimize some of the wasted expenditures on the marketing campaigns. If some particular print campaign is not effective, probably you may have a relook at that and probably invest that money into digital marketing here. And what is financial analytics? It's a field that gives different views of company financial data. It helps in business to understand the performance of an organization, measure and manage the value of tangible and intangible assets of an organization. It helps the management manage the investments of a company, whether they are being rightly done or not. And we have seen in the past that many companies have not done so well. What could be the reasons? They can find out from the best practices, forecast the variations in the market, increase the functionalities of information systems by providing better results. One of the common stock market usage of financial analytics is stock market trends and prediction, which is closely watched by the customers who are use stock as an investment. Another very popular analytical domain is called health analytics. In this, we try to describe the health. We try to collect data from four areas within the healthcare, which is our claims and cost data, pharma and research. A lot of research happens, and the drug tests which are happening. They try to collect the data, how effective the drugs has been. Clinical data collected from electronic medical records in terms of lab tests, the medicines given, the prescription given, the diagnosis, how effective has been those diagnosis, how often the customer has reported for a particular treatment. Also, we collect the sentiment analysis, how did the customer feel, the behavior. So all these types of data is captured in healthcare analytics, and this helps in better health prediction. And if somebody has gone through a particular operation, doctors, they advise you to come regularly, and they do fill up a form every time when you visit them, and they do a lot of research and analysis on that in trying to give the best treatment possible. Politics also has started using analytics. In the traditional campaign, we have seen speakers urging people to vote for a specific party. But we have also seen that it could reach only the specific people, the audience only. It was not a mass campaign. But now the analytics in politics is changing. People know how to segment the customers, what are their needs, how to, what to say to which type of customers. They run their campaigns, which is now a data-driven campaign. And a lot of political parties have found success in this concept methodology of using data in their political political movement. We have also seen parties giving their membership to their candidates based on their popularity in social network platform also. So there are like this, there are many multiple domains like crime analytics, when we try to find out the likely crime which is going to happen. There's learning analytics, there's the sports, and whenever we watch football, cricket or anything, we have a lot of analytics in terms of predictions, in terms of what is likely to happen, who's going to win, what are the odds of a winning. So in this way, we can apply data analytics to various domains here. Let's look at the types and levels of analytics here. When we are looking at the various types, we need to know about data-driven organizations, then what levels they would be, and also before that, we would also like to know how the data can be converted into wisdom, which is being used by various organizations to get better insights. This particular infographic tries to explain you how data can be converted into wisdom. When we are dealing with data in a raw form, does not have any value. Data has to be converted into a piece of knowledge, a piece of information by certain processing. And then from that, we grasp the patterns, and this becomes a knowledge. And when we find reasons to these patterns, then we understand. And that gives us wisdoms, and then brings some decision making. So in this way, companies are using data in a stepwise manner to become more wiser in terms of decision making, doing better in their organizations here. So data is collected from the past, and it is converted into information, then knowledge, and the wisdom. This infographic tries to explain you how a data is being converted into wisdom in various organizations. So what is a data-driven organization? Are all organizations data-driven? This is what somebody had to say about it. A data-driven company is an organization where every person who can use the data to make better decision. A person who's trying to use the data to have a better decision should have an access to the data they need and when they need. It's about right data at the right time for the right purpose. Being data-driven is not about being seeing a few canned reports at the beginning or every day or week. It's about giving the business decision makers the power to explore data independently, even if they are working with big or disparate data sources. So data-driven compliant companies are relentlessly trying to measure and monitor the pulse of business through the data, and doing so in a continuous and often automated manner. So far, in last few 10 to 15 years, we have been more concerned about creating data, and that's why a lot of ERP system, a lot of database management, a lot of web-based systems have come in. And now, having created data, now organizations are thinking of how to utilize this data which they have created, and trying to gain the knowledge, trying to become wiser from this data. So what are the objectives to qualify? It should be able to do not only draw data from variety of internal and external sources, but also be able to blend the data in analytical engines and distill it down to actionable insights. So this is what they should be doing on a regular basis. Get a data from various sources and see that they are able to get the actionable insights. Just not getting some few graphs. They should be able to find out what is going wrong, what is right, and how we can make it better. These insights should drive real-time decision-making that infuses every level of organization. The data should yield quantified results downstream that in turn inform the organization about which data sources are yielding results. They should know which data is more relevant, more important, which data gives us better decision-making. This is a very important part of any data-driven organization. And here, in a data-driven organization, everyone should own the data. What normally happens is data is owned by very few people, selected people, and they are not willing to share. And this is where the problem happens. So it's very important that people who are in a decision-making body and all down to up channel, they and who need the data, who have to take, who have to get insights from the data, they have access to all the kind of data which they need. So some of the characteristics of a data-driven organizations are good leadership, liquidity, usage of data, accessibility, and also very important, the protection and ethics also. It's just not that the data should be available with everyone. Yes, there has to be a control access, but it should be available when they need it. And there has to be a leadership platform who would be working, who would be taking decision on the day on the basis of data. Such an organization can be called a data-driven organization. So what are the types of data analytics here? It starts from your descriptive, diagnostic, predictive, and prescriptive. What is descriptive? When the data tells you, when you want to know, when you want to answer the questions, what's happening in my business, basically you are trying to do descriptive analytics here. You are trying to create a certain graph, you are trying to summarize this data here. So this is what you do at the descriptive level of analytics here. When you're trying to answer a question, why is it happening? Basically, you are doing diagnostic analytics. You are able to drill down, you are trying to find out the correlation between the various factors, the variables. And when you are trying to answer what's likely to happen, it's something you are trying to predict something, or you are trying to find out what will be my question, like what will be my sales if I keep a price of an item like this. So what you are trying to do is when you are trying to predict about the future sales. So this is what is predictive analytics. And prescriptive analytics is what do I need to do to get my sales like this. So if you say I want a sales of 1,000 crores, what should be my the price of an item? So these are the four types of analytics here, from going from descriptive to diagnostic to predictive and prescriptive. This also can be seen from the level, these four types can also seen from the four levels types. Descriptive, basically what happened, what you are basically doing at this level is you're creating reports, you're creating certain alerts, and you're mapping into your system here. When you're doing diagnostics, you're trying to answer why did it happen. You are doing some queries, data mining, and some statistical techniques like correlation, covariance, and what will happen. Then you are trying to run forecasts. You are trying to simulate certain situations, and you are trying to do linear regression, logistic regression, decision trees, machine learning techniques. And in prescriptive, you are basically doing optimization. You are seeing all the machines probably on the high best level under those constraints. So it helps you plan better. So these are the four levels of analytics. Again, sometimes called four types of analytics. But there are some of the organizations are called them eight levels. And what are these levels? They have both diagrams the same, but they have drawn input in a different way to have a better visual impact. So it starts down from the standard reports where we are trying to answer the question like what happened, when did it happen? And then it moves on to the ad hoc reporting, how many, how often, where. And then it moves to query, which is drilled down queries, where exactly is the problem? You are trying to answer this question. Alerts, what actions are needed, what to do if your sales are going down? Statistical analysis, why is this happening? Is it because the price is high or probably we are not running the campaigns correctly? Forecasting, next step. What if these trends continue? So what is going to happen? Predictive modeling. What will happen next? Then at the highest level, we are trying to optimize. How do we do things better? We want to do better sales, we want to have a better efficiency, we want to have better productivity. How we can make it happen? So this is the level, this is the eighth level of analytics which companies are trying to achieve here, but they all have to go through the standard process from 1 to 8. You cannot straight away reach up to level 8. You have to go in a stepwise methodical fashion. Another view of this again analytics is this. Summary reports, what happened? Ad hoc report, what happened when A and B are paired? You want to group them together? Where exactly is the problem? What actions are needed? Why is this happening? What if these trends continue? What will happen next? What's outcome create value? So my organization asks these questions, try to build the analytical model. Next, we look at the data mining model, which is industry-wise used by many organizations here. And that model is called the CRISP model. So this is an abstract model. This is basically list down the steps, how to do a data mining process. It is a cross-industry standard process for data mining. It's an open standard process model that describes common approaches used by the data mining expert and is widely used in analytical modeling. So what are these steps? And before these steps, let's look at a Venn diagram here. What is data mining about? Data mining is the process of discovering patterns in large data sets involving methods at the intersection of machine learning, statistics, and database systems. So here you in the infographic, you can see data mining overlapping with the databases, machine learning, statistics, pattern recognition. So these are the various domain it overlaps with and how the data mining has evolved through the stages. First, we had initially statistics coming up, then there was a computer age where you find a lot of computer programming, programming languages, the databases getting database languages, where data getting stored. And then when you had a large data, then people started mining this large data and finding various patterns. And today we are in the stage of big data revolution, where we have huge trillions of records getting created on a daily basis analyzing this data. So what does this model tell you about how to do a data mining? This is in an abstract manner. So it starts from the business understanding. Probably it could be a goal setting. You are trying to say improve the sales. If the business problem could be this, and you would be setting up expert people to do that. So then we would be collecting the data, because any kind of data mining process starts from data, and you would be acquiring data from various sources, from ERP models, from the Excel files, or from the blogs, or from the social media. So you would be getting this data from various sources, integrating them, and also checking for this quality, whether it is in that format or not. And then the next stage, once data is now available to you, it is very important you prepare it for the next stage of modeling. And this may involve a little bit of transformation, cleaning, maybe removing or missing records or missing columns there. And also probably sometimes it involves data reduction also. Having got the data ready for a modeling technique, this is where you look at the machine learning and statistical techniques, like doing linear regression, decision trees, clustering, or whichever technique you want to do. And now we run these various techniques, try to assess these techniques at the next stage, and then evaluate the results, whether the technique has been accurate or not, is it giving good results or not. And then we feed it back to the business understanding and see whether we are correctly applying it or not. Once we find it that our modeling technique has been properly done and it is as per the business requirements, then we can easily deploy it into a business system. Let's say we understand if we decrease the price of an item by 10%, we are going to have an increase of sales by 20%. And if we create a modeling technique and we check it from the business perspective, then probably we can deploy this model and we can decrease the prices and then put it into sale. So in this way, we will be able to use our data analytics to improve the business processes. So what are the some of the terms when we are using the data mining? We get thrown with the various types of terms like machine learning, data mining, and statistics. What does that actually mean? To some of these terms, from this infographic, is you have to look. Statistic quantifies numbers. Data mining explains the patterns. Machine learning predicts with the models, and AI behaves and reasons. So this is how our data analytical domain is evolving. It is moving from statistic to data mining, to machine learning, to AI. And this is how you will find you also getting evolved from one level to the other. So how to become a data scientist, data analyst? Having gone through the various analytical terms and the skill set. So a standard methodology, a recommended methodology could be like this. Pick up a domain, business, marketing, etc. to apply analytics. Understand about data properties and statistics. Learn any programming language, R, Python, SAS to do practical analysis. Because until unless you know some tool, you will not be able to really analyze for yourself, and that exercise will become a theoretical. Collect the data and follow the CRISP modeling technique, that is data mining. Translate your business problem to a statistical data mining model to coding. Never bring your problem into straightaway code. First, bring it to a statistical problem, statistical model, and then translate into how you would be executing the code. And once the results are being thrown out from this programming tool, interpret the results from the domain point of view. Create a lot of graphs and visualizations to analyze the large data, because we have any hand in more than lakh record or maybe millions of records, you cannot see them one screen. So it's a good idea to really put them in graphs and see the patterns coming out. And also it's very important to find the best modeling technique for your data analytical problem. Not all modeling technique help you are the best models. So you will have to be very selective, and this will come through trial and experiment, and you will learn from it and build a model, test it, and then your learning will keep improving. And this particular analytical modeling is why it is called an art and a science. Because you have to do in a very scientific manner. There are certain steps to be executed. And there obviously there is an art, because you need to interpret, you need to be creative in your modeling technique. And you may be selected, you may be selecting the best model. And how do you select? It'll depend on your creativity there. So this is the end of what is on analytics, and which we try to understand what is analysis, analytics, the various domains of analytics, what are the data skills required to analysis. And also we learned about the CRISP modeling technique, and also some of the terms related the related areas to data mining. Thank you so much. Keep watching series on data analytics by Henry Harvin Education. Thank you.